Sorry. Hi, I'm Linda McNamee, and welcome to Something to Talk About. Thank you for tuning in, and hopefully you will enjoy learning lots about the Rainbow Girls Assembly. I think I said that right. You'll correct me later. Before we begin, I would like to suggest that if you do have a question or comment, and feel free to call in this evening, 781-270-9199, or feel free to email me if you think of an additional topic that you'd like to see on the show at some point. Or if you have a question, you can always email me at talk@bcattv.org. So I'm there checking the email every day, so I will be happy to get back to you. And again, before we start our official topic, I would like to thank the crew here and the staff here. We have Mike Duvall and Corey McNeil, who are staff members here, and they help keep the place running, and they do an amazing and fabulous job. And I would also like to thank Colleen Moore, who is a volunteer here and gives up her Wednesday evenings to come and give me a hand helping out with the show every week, and she kind of has to listen to my topic of conversation by default. So hopefully she's going to enjoy it too. And last, I would like to thank my husband, Paul, for staying home for Daddy Date Night with Gwyneth and Evan. And I'm hoping that Evan's going to feel better. Evan's got a little cold. And I hope Gwyneth is going to enjoy her evening, because she actually kicked me out of the house tonight. Say, Mommy, you can go now. So I hope you guys are having fun. And I will see Gwyneth and Evan in the morning. And thank you, Paul. And thank you, everyone. And now, for the topic of conversation this evening, I would like to introduce Debbie Kenny and Amy Randall, and both of you are involved in the Rainbow Assembly.
Absolutely.
So thank you so much for coming.
Well, thank you for having
There's
us.
There's a nice little chill in the air. It feels like fall, mm-hmm. So rainbows kind of perk up everything. And okay, I digress. Let's start. I think we're going to start with Debbie.
Okay.
And can you tell me a little bit about where you grew up, your history, where you went to school, and kind of how you got involved in the Rainbow Girls?
Mm-hmm. I grew up in Acton, so pretty nearby. I went to school at Acton-Boxborough Regional High School, and eventually attended college at Mount Holyoke College.
You went to Mount Holyoke?
I did.
You're one of the Seven Sisters!
Yes.
I went to Smith.
There you go.
Excellent.
So you know what I'm talking about. Anyway, when I was in high school, I was asked by a friend if I would join the Rainbow Girls. Mm-hmm. I said, what? I didn't know what it was about, mm-hmm. but I was looking for something at that point, an opportunity to make some new friends, to do some different kinds of activities. I was a shy kid, wasn't involved in a lot of things. So she dragged me along. And
the rest is history.
I've been involved in Rainbow originally as a girl. Mm-hmm. I got a lot of great skills, great experiences, great lifelong friendships out of my participation, which is what led me to want to be an advisor when I grew up. And so I've been doing that for a long time. Mm-hmm. I'm involved with the Assembly in Concord, and I'm also involved at the state level with the membership committee level that's working on getting the word out a little bit more about Rainbow, because it's sometimes a really well-kept secret. It shouldn't be. We don't want it to be. and trying to increase membership. So I've been working on that. Professionally, I'm a business person. I have a marketing background. And I've found that the skills that I learned in Rainbow, the leadership skills, the public speaking skills, mm-hmm. The confidence that I developed has been hugely helpful to me in my career and my business success.
Excellent. Now, right now you are an advisor to mm-hmm. the Concord Group.
Right.
What exactly does an advisor do?
So I'm the mother advisor,
okay.
Which is, you know, think den mother, something like
okay.
that. So I'm the key person who works with the girls, helps them in the meetings, plan their activities and things like that. But we actually have a very strong group of advisors. Okay. Some of them.
Oh, so there's more than one advisor?
Far more than one.
Oh,
and in our assembly, we have 11. Members of our advisory board, but you can have anywhere, I think, from 7 to 15 adults
right.
on an advisory board. They can start at the age of 23, so there's a little break, because
mm-hmm.
Rainbow Girls can be in Rainbow up till they're 21.
Okay.
They can come on an advisory board at 23, and it's a very multi-generational kind of a thing.
Hmm.
So there might be younger members, there might be more of the grandparent generation sometimes
okay.
participating, some of whom have even been Rainbow Girls themselves.
So some of who, so you don't necessarily need to have grown up in the program in order to be an advisor.
To be an advisor, you either need to have grown up in the program,
okay.
So that's what we call a majority member.
That would make sense.
Or we're sponsored by Masonic organizations.
Okay.
So we have members on our advisory board who may be members of a local Masonic lodge,
okay.
Order of the Eastern Star, Order of the Amaranth, or there's the Order of the White Shrine.
Okay.
So those are the folks that are providing guidance for the girls and helping them and helping to run the assemblies.
Excellent.
Yeah.
That sums it all up. Okay. And now earlier, before the show, we were chatting a little bit, and you said, Amy said that you were invited from a friend, and you just mentioned that you were invited. Is that, or has that been the primary way of recruiting members?
I would say yes.
Okay.
Primarily, it's word of mouth. It's one Rainbow girl finding another girl who she thinks would enjoy Rainbow and telling her about it and letting her know about it. Sometimes, though, you find out about Rainbow through a show like this. Through
So you don't need that personal invitation.
You do not have to have a personal invitation. You can find someone and you know they'll tell you about Rainbow and invite you in as well. So. And again, a lot of daughters. We were originally developed as a organization for the Daughters of Masons, the Freemasons.
Okay. Back in like 1922?
1922, about 90 years ago.
Okay.
So been around for a long time. And for their friends,
okay.
but that's not true anymore. It's an open organization for any girl who meets the age requirements, really.
Who wants to learn leadership through community service?
Who wants to learn leadership, citizenship, competence through community service, have an opportunity to have fun, make friends, and provide service.
Okay. Don't want to leave Amy shut out. Tell me a little bit about your background, how you got involved.
Well,
I know you got a personal invitation because
I
just said that part. But
I had a friend who sent me an invitation in the mail. And I had no idea what it was, but I said, why not? I'll check it out. So I went to a prospective member's party, and they told me a little bit about what they do, and I still didn't really know what I was getting into. But I decided to join, and here I am 7 years later. Absolutely love it, and I'm having a great time.
And you are the Grand Worthy Advisor at the state level.
Yes.
What exactly does that mean?
Grand Worthy Advisor would
be... Get to wear a cool hat or...
Well, I get to wear a cool crown.
Ooh, even better.
It's equivalent to a state president for any type of group.
Okay.
So it's for the state of Massachusetts, we have the local assemblies and they have their corps of officers in the assembly. And they have a worthy advisor, which is like a president.
Okay.
And then at the state level, we have the same corps of officers. It's just from girls all over the state who participate.
Okay. Now, each local assembly, do they need to have a representative at the state level? Or is it just kind of like if they feel like participating at the state level?
They do not have to, no.
Okay.
If they want to, some assemblies have one or two girls participate,
okay.
some have six or seven participate, so.
How did you earn that role as, or become Grand Worthy Advisor?
I started out in my local assembly. I went through many offices in my assembly and I became Worthy Advisor. And then I was a Grand Representative, which is I represented Massachusetts in other states. So I was the representative to New Jersey 1 year, then Ohio, and then Mississippi.
So did you have to travel to all those places?
I traveled to two of them.
Okay.
I traveled to New Jersey and Ohio, and I spoke with a girl from Mississippi throughout the whole year and got to know her that way. And then I served as two other state offices, grand offices.
Okay.
And then I tried out for the position of Grantworthy Advisor, so I had to write an application, and then I went for a tryout, and then I was selected by our state board.
What was involved in the tryout? Was it like a you had to prepare a speech, or?
I had to show them the floor work that we do in our meetings.
Okay.
And I had to recite a piece of ritual from memory, and answer some questions that they had.
Now, if you're involved at the local level, I don't know if either one of you told you, I have my cheat sheet and you guys are already pulling me off on tangents. If you are involved at the local level, do you have to be of an officer position at that local level at the same time as being an officer at the state level, like either a grand representative or a Grantworthy Advisor? Do you have to also hold an office at the state level or at the local level?
You don't have to, but with our assemblies being rather small, I am still an officer in my local assembly.
Okay.
Most of the time, if the assembly is small, we only have a few really large assemblies.
Okay.
But if the assembly is small, then yes, you would be serving both the assembly.
It seems like a pretty big commitment to make to serve at the local level as well as the state level at the same time. It seems pretty major.
A lot of the girls are very happy to do it.
Wow.
Know, they really enjoy Rainbow. They have fun and they love being involved in those kinds of roles. So they're happy to do both. And depending on the office, some of them are more commitment than others. Amy, as Grantworthy Advisor, has a huge commitment in what she's doing. She travels to all the other assemblies in the state, or as many of them as she can get to.
How many are there? Do you happen to know roughly?
There are 26 in Massachusetts.
That's a lot.
And pretty spread out. So there's quite a bit of traveling that, that she does to go visit them
and
their meetings.
Probably thankful you don't live in California or Texas to do that.
But as she told you, as a grand representative, she had the opportunity to travel to other states and other countries as well. It is an international organization.
Wow. Now, when you're done at the state level, do you want to participate at the international level?
Well, our international level is set up a little bit differently. It's the older, how would you?
There's there are adults who are in the top offices.
Okay.
But at the, what we call the Supreme Assembly, which is the international convention.
Okay.
Of the Rainbow Girls, it happens every 2 years.
Okay.
There are girls selected from each state. So Amy, who's Grantworthy Advisor in Massachusetts now, at the next Supreme Assembly will probably have the opportunity to do the work of a Supreme level officer. But the actual running of the organization is done at the adult level internationally.
Okay. And this, is it a conference that every 2 years?
It's a convention.
A convention, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Where's the next one, do you know?
Maryland. It's
well,
wherever.
That doesn't sound very international.
Well, we've had, let's see, a few years ago, the last one we had was in Michigan, and the one before that was in Nebraska.
Okay.
So it depends on where our Supreme, where the advisor is from.
Okay.
So this current, the one coming up will be in Maryland, and then the one after that will be in Rhode Island.
Okay.
Which we're very excited about because it's actually the New England states that are hosting it. So we expect to be very involved in the Rhode Island Providence event.
Excellent.
So we're all going to be going to Baltimore, hopefully, so that we can kind of get familiar with what needs to be done and all the work that has to happen.
If you have time, check out Oriole Park at Camden Yards. If you're a baseball fan, they have the most amazing behind-the-scenes tour there. It's really cool. So if you happen to be there, have a few extra hours. So I digress. I'm sorry.
You know, and that's one of the things that's really nice about Rainbow as an organization is it gives girls the opportunity to To travel, to meet girls from other places. The international presence we have, Rainbow Girls in Australia, in Aruba,
Those would be nice to go visit. It's let's have one in Aruba
in Italy,
in January.
So there's, Germany.
Oh, wow.
So obviously, since we're in the U.S., we're mostly traveling within the
right.
U.S., but there are opportunities as well to meet girls from other
countries.
Now,
at these conventions, are there ever representatives from Germany or Australia or Aruba that come here? Do you have the opportunity to meet some of the international?
I have when I've gone to the Supreme Assembly that is held every other year.
Okay.
That's when you meet a lot of the girls from out of country, which is really neat. We also, in New England, have a lot from Canada come.
Okay. Now, does everybody speak English, or do you have to learn a foreign language?
A lot of them do.
Well, obviously Australia, you probably don't have too much difficulty, but like Germany, do you speak German?
In Germany, I think a lot of the Rainbow Girls actually are English-speaking.
Yeah. But a lot of the European countries, they start really young learning English. So.
But in some of the countries, they are, they're doing our memorized ritual work. They're doing it in their local language.
Oh, wow.
So it, kind of depends on where it is.
Okay, we talked a little bit about your role and both of you coming up through the program. Can we back up a little bit and just talk about what a Rainbow Girl is and what she does and how old she has to be and just kind of like, what made you stay?
Well, we have from ages 8 to 11 or 8 through 10. We have a pledge group. And so those are the girls that are interested in joining Rainbow but are not old enough yet.
Okay.
So they learn a little bit about Rainbow a little bit at a time. And they usually have a meeting once, maybe twice a month. And they also do their own service projects and they have their fun events. And they do a lot with Rainbow to get to know what it's all about to see if they want to really join it when they turn 11. And when you turn 11, you can join Rainbow. It's from 11 to 21.
Okay.
Well, it's from 11 to 20, and then you can stay in one extra year if you're very active and you want to. And we do a lot of community service, which is one of the main reasons that I loved staying involved. And our motto is Get Girls Ready for Life, which is extremely true. We learn public speaking, poise, etiquette, it gives you the tools that you'll need to succeed in life.
Okay.
Which is the biggest thing I would say.
Definitely.
What are some of the examples of some of the service projects that either Rainbow Girls do or that you personally were involved in?
The ones, my service project, when I was in my local assembly, I had to put together a service project and I raised $500 to buy a cow for Heifer International.
Oh, okay, cool.
So we do some things that involve raising money to give to a service organization.
Okay.
We also do things like cleaning up local gardens, collecting items. Our biggest statewide one is the Shriners Hospitals. We collect can tabs that go to the Shriners Hospital.
Mm-hmm.
We also have made like the tie blankets. And
what are those?
So the fabric blankets that you cut out and you tie the knots, and then we donated those to
called.
The hospital.
Never knew what they were called.
We've done Cradles to Crayons, which was a huge one.
Okay.
This year, the state service project is the Greater Boston Food Bank, so we've been collecting non-perishable food items for that. What other ones have we
been involved in?
That's a good representation.
Yeah.
Sure. In our assembly in Concord, right now we're going to do a dance to raise money for Toys for Tots.
Excellent.
That's our Worthy Advisors project. And last term, we did, the girls planned and wrote and put on a puppet show, and they made puppets for the children at a place called Why Me in Worcester, which is a house for children with cancer in their families that they can go to. So that was really fun to go there and be with the kids and provide them with something good to do, something the girls could do kind of hands-on. So all kinds of different ideas. And the ideas are typically the girls' ideas. They decide what it is that they want to do.
So it doesn't necessarily have to be something that's been done before.
Usually isn't.
Neat. And how often are the meetings? You said like when they're in that 8 to 10, it's usually they meet like once or twice a month.
Our meetings are twice a month for Rainbow.
Twice a month. And yes. At those meetings, you kind of plan out the next steps of these service projects?
The meetings are more to discuss what upcoming events are going on, okay. What we have done, what we would like to do. Okay. So we just kind of recap everything that's going on.
And the meetings are a big part of what makes Rainbow a little bit different mm-hmm. from other organizations that people might be familiar with. Okay. The girls meet in Masonic lodges.
Okay.
And they have a formal opening ceremony for their meeting, okay. A formal closing ceremony, and there's other kinds of ceremonies they might do when a new member's joining, okay. When offices are being installed in their new position.
So it seems like there's a big
things like that
impact or influence on the formal ceremony. So you mentioned, you know, the gowns and the
yes.
The ceremonies. There's an aspect of Rainbow which is very formal, where the girls really get to develop that sense of poise, to speak in a different kind of way. Mm-hmm. They do wear formal gowns and crowns, some of them, the officers, the top officers
wear heels,
crowns.
Though.
They're yeah. a little heeled. So that's something that is different from other organizations, and it's okay. something that for the girls gives them a chance to, you know, feel confident and maybe pretty and to dress mm-hmm. up a little bit, but also to feel a little bit powerful
yeah.
In what okay. they're doing, and, you know, where they're in their office and they're performing their work in a different way. And it's really quite lovely and different from okay. what people might expect. And when they run their meetings, they're running the meetings using parliamentary procedure. The worthy advisor is presiding. She has a gavel. She's at the front of
wow.
the room.
Cool.
Absolutely. And, you know, they're learning how to make motions and second motions and, you know, run meetings in a way that's done, you know, in Congress.
In every organization.
And,
you know,
all these kinds of things. So
and
that's where some of the leadership training comes in
okay.
as well.
And you as mother advisor kind of work on letting the girls know what the structure is and
mm-hmm. oh, kind of guide okay. them. And in the assembly room, I actually sit, as a mother advisor, I would sit next to the worthy advisor.
Okay.
She's in the top office, you know, the top spot, but I'm there to kind of gently, you know, suggest and guide and direct when needed. Because
steal the gavel if necessary.
Occasionally, no, I wouldn't do that.
Overrule.
But yeah, just have to kind of help them out because they're learning. Mm-hmm. You know, as they go along. So they don't usually need much help. They know what they're doing. They're pretty confident.
Excellent. Now, we mentioned that as Grand Worthy Advisor, you're traveling to all of the different assemblies in Massachusetts.
Yes.
And you said there are 26?
Yes.
Okay. Which ones, other than Concord, are local to Burlington? Like, if somebody in Burlington wanted to get involved,
mm-hmm.
where would they have to go?
There's an assembly called Wamisit Assembly, which is in Tewksbury, which is
okay.
quite close. There's Lexington has an assembly, Concord, we mentioned. Wakefield
okay.
also. And is there another one?
I
have notes. Concord,
notes are good.
Wakefield, and Bill Ricca.
Oh, Bill Ricca, right next door.
Bill Ricca as well, so quite
now,
a few opportunities.
I think before the show you were mentioning that, or maybe it was during the show, I'm in a time warp, some of the assemblies are smaller and some are larger. What is like, is there an average number?
Some like assemblies are very small and have only 3 or 4 girls,
okay.
while some are larger and have like 15 to 20.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So I would say around maybe 10 to 12 is usually where we see them.
Okay.
I think that's about right. And the an ideal size for an assembly, there are actually 20 different offices.
Wow.
In an
ideally
assembly.
20 people.
So at least 20, even more. Okay. They have opportunities to do different kinds of things. So, you know, as long as you have enough to fill some of the top offices mm-hmm. and, you know, feel like people are involved
Good
and
stuff.
Showing up for
now,
things,
Now, to somebody
it works
in
fine.
A smaller assembly, if there aren't 20 people, do they have to fill multiple roles, or do you just leave them empty, or is it a combination of both?
It's a combination.
We also have assemblies that are close to each other. They'll go and visit, and they'll help each other out during the meetings, and especially when they have the new members joining, they'll help them out during that ceremony.
So, like, for example, the Lexington and Concord assemblies could kind of do a partnering event or something.
Absolutely. Yes. Okay. And the girls, we have meetings, as Amy said, two nights a month or 2 days a month, but some of the girls go out to rainbow meetings a lot more than that. The different assemblies meet on different days of the week, different times of the month. So they might go to their own meetings, and then they may have a few pet assemblies they like to visit regularly. So I know my girls in Concord almost never miss a Newton meeting. They love going to the Newton meetings. They've bonded with the girls there. I think in Amy's home assembly in Middleborough, there's some other assemblies nearby.
We go to Taunton a lot and Plymouth a lot.
And do they reciprocate when they come to you? Okay.
Yes.
Well, that's neat. Now, has there out of something like the sharing, has there ever been a merger? Or do they usually maintain separately?
I think there have been in the past mergers, and sometimes there have been splits. Some of the assemblies, new assemblies gotten big, and then they've broken into formed a new assembly. We have two new assemblies in Massachusetts. Our newest assemblies are the Newton one that I mentioned.
Okay.
And we have a new assembly in Gardner. That's the newest Massachusetts Rainbow Assembly. And there's a group working on trying to form a new assembly in Danvers right now as well.
Okay.
So hopefully
now, if somebody wants to form a new assembly, can do established assemblies kind of help them out and guide them, or what are the resources for them?
Yeah, they have all the resources from the state level, the grand assembly.
And you get to go visit.
Amy would go visit, but we have a lot of resources. As I said, I'm on the membership committee at the state level, and one of our responsibilities is to provide resources and guidance and help to the newer assemblies with those kinds of things, how to recruit members and what they need to do. And then the top adult office in the state is called the Supreme Deputy.
Okay.
And our Supreme Deputy, Ms. Susan Torrey, is there to provide a lot of the materials and guidance and support that a new assembly would need to work with a mother advisor. And also at the adult level, we have what we call grand deputies, which are sort of regional managers, I guess you could say, who are usually somebody who's been a mother advisor, has a lot of experience with Rainbow, and then works with the mother advisors in her district to support and help her with those kinds of things. So they'd be very involved as well.
Okay. Backing up even further, when and how were the Rainbow Girls established?
So Rainbow was established.
There's new ones coming up, but
we were established in 1922.
Okay. Now, where did it start? Was it
McAlester, Oklahoma?
Wow. Okay.
Actually, out of the Midwest, it was founded by a minister named Reverend Mark Sexton, and he was a Freemason, and he was involved with some of the other Masonic organizations. And there was an organization for boys at that time called the Order of DeMolay.
Okay. Are they still around today?
They are. And we have active DeMolay in Massachusetts. And there felt like there was a need for something for girls, something that would provide girls with the opportunity to have some of these benefits that the Masonic organizations had to teach these girls some of the life lessons and principles of Masonry, and so he sat down and he wrote an absolutely beautiful ritual with the full ceremony of initiation, the symbolism of the rainbow and all that goes with that, and founded the organization. So that's
symbolism
how we got
of the
started.
Rainbow. Is that something you can share with me?
Yes. The rainbow
other than just pretty lights?
It has several symbols. I mean, each of the colors in the rainbow has a different meaning for us. And we mentioned that there are 20 offices in Assembly. Each of the colors of the rainbow has an office that goes with it. Amy can tell you what those are.
So we have red, which is symbolizes love. And then orange is religion. Yellow is nature. Green is immortality. Blue is fidelity. Indigo is patriotism. And violet is service.
And you did them in order,
I
too.
I did.
And most watching all those shows with my kids learning the order of the rainbow.
You won't find too many rainbow girls who can't go through that. But in the ceremony of
but then,
initiation.
Okay, that's seven. So then you still have 13 other offices that aren't color related.
So why don't you explain some of those?
Well, we have faith, hope, charity, worthy associate advisor, and worthy advisor are our top officers. They're the top five, which I had mentioned to you earlier, where the girl will start when she starts to go up to the office of worthy advisor, will start in faith and then work her way up through those.
Okay.
And then we'll have a recorder and a treasurer.
Okay.
And we have a confidential observer and an outer observer, which guard the doors during our meetings.
Drill leader?
Drill leader, right. Drill leader helps to escort people around the room during the meetings.
Okay.
And
you could also be a musician, choir director.
Help bring songs to the meetings.
I would not fit good in that role.
Well, there's different roles for different people. And then again about the rainbow symbolism.
Okay.
So in our initiation ceremony, a girl is symbolically brought on a journey that represents her search for the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. And
Is there one? There is,
and it has many treasures in it. There are things that help girls learn to be good citizens and learn that confidence and all those kinds of things. And so along the journey, they learn about those lessons that Amy mentioned, the lesson of love and religion and nature and the different colors and what they might mean to a girl as she's growing up and as she enters adulthood. So it's really quite lovely in how that works.
Cool. Now, it started in 1920. I'm going to put you on the spot here. Started in 1922 in Oklahoma. When did some of the Massachusetts assemblies begin? Like, when did Concord get an assembly?
Concord Assembly started in 1945.
Okay.
So
it's been
around
a while.
A good long time. And continuously, you know, one set of people going through, somebody else in that top worthy advisor office all the way through. We have adults that, even older than I am, who have been...
That's not possible.
Who were rainbow girls.
Joking, I'm kidding.
In Concord and are still involved on the advisory board or in other ways. But so the way that rainbow started to spread... was through the Masonic lodges. There were Masonic lodges in many different places, and they saw the benefits of the organization. So Masonic lodges, or there's the Order of the Eastern Star, Order of Amaranth, which are similar organizations, associated organizations for women, would say, well, we'd like to sponsor an assembly in our town. We want this for our girls who live here. So it started out, the first assembly in Massachusetts was Boston Assembly Number 1.
Okay.
And all the assemblies are numbered.
Okay.
Kind of in the order that they were chartered.
Okay.
So Concord is actually number 53.
Wow.
So we were not the first by any means. So at one time there were well over 100 assemblies in Massachusetts.
Okay, wow.
Internationally, I think the same thing. There were the countries where there were a lot of Americans that were familiar with the organization, especially Germany. It started out because of the German bases there, and then has expanded
presence.
That way. Okay. Or Masonic lodges in other countries that wanted the same thing for their daughters, for the girls in their community.
So you're like, Germany, maybe I'll do some graduate work in Germany. Yeah, that sounds good. Okay, so you kind of talked about the representation of what the rainbow means and all the different colors. Is that kind of why it was chosen as a name, or was there another reason why you chose the name Rainbow Girls?
Not you personally, but... It wasn't me. I actually wasn't around in 1922. But I think that's the main reason. It's because of the symbolism that our founder decided he could communicate effectively through that. And so our official name is the International Order of the Rainbow for Girls. And it has been, we actually added the international part at some point, started out as Order of the Rainbow for Girls.
Started back in 1922, the goal was, you know, international wasn't high
exactly.
on the list of priority.
Exactly, it came later.
It was there, but not, okay. So you mentioned that the Rainbow Assemblies are sponsored by Masonic groups. Mm-hmm. Just out of curiosity, and I know this is probably really obvious to most of the world, but how are the Masons associated with, like, the Shriners?
I don't know that it's obvious. The Shriners are sort of an advanced level in Masonry. So anybody who's a Shriner is also a Mason in a local Masonic lodge. And then they choose to go on to additional levels and to become Shriners.
Okay.
So that's how that works.
And is there a female equivalent of a Shriner?
I think the Ladies Oriental Shrine, the Order of the White Shrine, is connected with Shriners. I don't know if it's equivalent exactly. I could be wrong about that. Do you know?
I'm not really sure.
We're not too sure about that. But there are...
Sorry, told you I'd be tangent. Yeah, that's why I have my cheat sheet over here.
The women's organizations are independent, just like Rainbow is actually independent from Freemasonry. We're our own organization with our own structures, but we're sponsored by the Masons. And that's true of the women's organizations as well. The Order of Eastern Star, Order of Amaranth, are two groups that are active in this area. They're not part of the Masonic organization. The Masonic organization is men. Mm-hmm. But they're affiliated with them. They're sponsored by them. They meet in their lodges. They kind of share members. Oftentimes, a lot of those organizations, the women's organizations, do have men who are members as well.
Okay.
And those men would be Masons. Okay. So there's a lot of connections between the different groups. And what we call it is, we call it the Masonic family.
Okay.
So, you know, everybody in the family can participate. We have the Order de Molay that we mentioned for the boys. We have the Order of Rainbow for the girls.
Now, the Order of de Molay, mm-hmm. is that the same age groupings?
Pretty similar.
It's 12 to 21, correct?
I think so.
12 to 21.
Okay, so it's close.
Yes.
Okay. Now, when I read on your website that Rainbow Girls was established in 1922, the first thing that popped into my mind was, hey, Girl Scouts were formed in 1912. How were the two organizations different? I think I kind of know how they were different back then because, you know, as you explained the name, but how have the organizations developed? Like, is the Rainbow Assembly from 1922 the same as today? Same goals, same vision, same mission?
We do have the same basic, like we follow the same traditions as when we were founded.
Okay.
And
because you mentioned the ceremony, is it still like the same ceremony that's performed and the history is there?
Yes. We change a little bit with the times, but for the most part, like all of our traditional work is the same.
Do you ever get compared to like the Girl Scouts or 4-H or some of the other?
We get compared to the Girl Scouts all the time. And we have many Rainbow Girls who are also Girl Scouts, very active in Girl Scouts as well. Okay. I know a lot of the girls in my assembly do both.
Okay.
And they get different benefits from the two organizations. I think the biggest difference besides what we already talked about, mm-hmm. which is the formal meetings and the ceremonies and rituals.
I don't remember ever wearing a gown in Girl Scouts. Definitely not a crown.
You know, Girl Scouts, when you think of Girl Scouts, you kind of think of camping and outdoors and things like that.
Which
and when you think of Rainbow, you kind of think of gowns and formal and crowns, so that's a big difference.
More traditional. It seems a lot more traditional.
Yes.
But one of the things I think is the most important difference is in Rainbow, an assembly is all the girls of that age range we've been talking about, 11 to 20, mm-hmm. together in one assembly.
Okay.
Unlike with the Girl Scouts or a lot of the other organizations where they're each grade level is in its own separate group, right? So you have your ninth graders together, or your mm-hmm. fifth graders together, whatever. In Rainbow, it's all one assembly.
Oh, okay.
All those girls are together, and the advantage of that is that...
they can teach each other.
Exactly. The older girls are role models for the younger girls, and as the younger girls move to greater levels of responsibility, mm-hmm. They have somebody to work with them, and they support each other and help each other. I think that creates a really special and unique environment for the girls.
Hmm. It's like we have our advisors, and we call them mom and dad, and all the girls with all the different ages, it really becomes like a family, which is very nice.
And then you have crazy Aunt Louise somewhere. No.
Could be.
Okay. I think you kind of already talked about the organizational structure. Well, you talked about the structure of the assembly itself, the local assembly, then the state assembly, then the national and international. Is there like an organizational structure that we haven't talked about yet within the local, other than, you know, those five, the Faith, Hope, Charity,
where the associate and
where the advisor? Is that like the structure? You know, there aren't like patrols or units or any of that subdivision, really. It's just
family. We all work together.
Okay.
Right, so an assembly, is that group we talked about, anywhere from 5 to 20 girls, and that's mm-hmm. the local group, and then the state level, the international level. That's pretty much how it works.
Okay. One of the questions that I had here was, like, what are the levels and requirements to pass from one to the other? Now, we talked about, I don't know, are there levels, like, for ages or levels for positions? Does everybody have to hold all the positions? And are there requirements to pass from one officership to another or one level to another? You know, how is the progress through the organization? Is there a structure to that?
Well, in the local assembly, most of the time, it kind of depends on the different assembly.
Okay.
For my local assembly, you have to be... serve a few different speaking positions in order to be qualified for the Office of Faith, which starts your journey to become worthy advisor.
Okay.
And in my assembly, you have to be 14 years old.
Okay.
Just so you have a little bit, you're a little bit more mature at that age, and you've had some experience doing other offices in the assembly. But you, for any of the other offices, there's really, you can take whichever office that you would like to. You apply to your advisory board, and you just say that this is what you're interested in doing, and then they put you where they see that you should be.
Now, before you leave a position, like you mentioned, the position of faith is focused on public speaking. Did I get that right? Or, yeah. So, if someone is really terrified of speaking in front of a group, do they stay in that role, or do they get out quickly, or do you have to stay somewhere until you master that skill set before moving on?
No, not the office doesn't have like a specific skill that you learn, because you learn all of the different skills during the different offices. I mean, I'm still learning all of the skills as I'm Grand Worthy Advisor this year.
Okay.
And the different offices, you'll stay in the position for 6 months. And you will memorize a part for that specific office.
Okay.
So when the new member joins during our initiation ceremony, you'll say that speaking part. And that will be what you have to do in order to pass to another station.
Okay.
So when we have a new girl who joins, if she's a little bit nervous or shy or isn't sure mm-hmm. what she wants to do, she may not even take an office at first. Usually they want to because they want to get into those white gowns.
So you have to wear a white gown. Only officers?
The officers wear the white gowns.
Okay, that was going to be the next question about dress
although
code.
Although sometimes they can fill in. So
they want the really big crown. No.
So sometimes they don't even take an office at all to begin if they're not ready. But typically they would, and they might start One of the offices we didn't mention is in our opening ceremony. We have girls who carry flags into the assembly room, and they typically will have a very short little speech that okay. they give a little tribute to the flag. It's usually 4 or 5 lines. And that's a really nice way for a girl to get started. Okay. She can learn the 4 or 5 lines, learn how to carry in her flag, as, you know, and that's it. Okay. So that's very comfortable to get started. And then once they've done that for a term and they want to do something else.
Plus, like you had mentioned, since all ages are present, seeing the older girls perform some of the roles, they might, that just watching might build their confidence.
Right. And sometimes they don't ever want to do a part where they're learning ritual. If they have a learning disability or something, mm-hmm. it's just not their thing. They might take on the role of treasurer or recorder or okay. Different kinds of things like that, choir director. Usually they'll go on next to maybe one of the color stations representing one of the colors of the rainbow that mm-hmm. we talked about. Those are fairly simple parts. They don't have to run anything or do anything crazy. They simply deliver their lecture.
Okay.
So they learn that. And so it's usually kind of a second tier that they would do. And once I've held a few different offices, they move up the chaplain office, the drill leader, which conducts kind of the floor mm-hmm. work around the room. Those are a little more okay. advanced. And once maybe they've held one or two of those, then they might feel like they're starting to feel ready to run for the okay. Office of Faith, which is an elected office.
Okay.
Which would
start
them.
No, the other ones elected?
Those are not, they're appointed.
Okay.
And when they run for the Office of Faith, that starts them on their journey to become the worthy advisor, where the girl is responsible for running all the activities of the assembly, planning all the fun activities, running all the meetings, all those kinds of things. The presiding officer, the worthy advisor, does that. So they work their way up to that point.
Okay. So tell me more about this dress code. You mentioned that everybody doesn't wear a white dress.
Our officers for the assembly will wear a white floor-length gown.
Okay.
So a lot of us go to David's Bridal and get them. The wedding dresses.
Oh, yeah.
And for grand officers, if they're traveling to different assemblies or going to receptions or anything along those lines, they mm-hmm. would wear a floor-length colored gown.
Okay.
And then for the grand officers...
And you get to pick the color.
Yes, you get to pick the color. for our grand officers, we have a traveling uniform, which is what I'm wearing today, which mm-hmm. is the khaki skirt and then the polo. And then in the local assemblies, most assemblies have now created a dress code for within their assembly. Most of the assemblies have the khaki skirt and then a mm-hmm. different colored polo.
Okay. So not always the blue.
Not all the blue, no.
The assemblies have different colors. Concord Assembly mm-hmm. has red shirts. But the girls don't necessarily wear those mm-hmm. in the meetings. They might wear them if they're going out visiting another assembly. But the girls, you know, what we emphasize when they're not in their gowns mm-hmm. is that they dress modestly and appropriately. And we're trying to teach them how to make good choices and what they're going to wear and to dress in a way that they're going to make a good impression on people. It's going to help them when they get into the workplace mm-hmm. later on.
Okay.
And they're able to make good selections about their choices of what they're wearing.
And I just found out that we have a phone call.
Ooh.
A viewer has called in. Can you hear us, viewer? Ooh, feedback. Somebody there?
Hello?
Lynn
Hello?
Is on the phone. Lynn, can you hear us?
I can barely hear you.
Okay, do you have a question?
I just have a couple comments. I'm very pleased and proud to see Rainbow being highlighted on your show. I was a member many years ago, was a huge part of my growing up, and I wanted to let people know that there are also opportunities for scholarships at the local and state level. And hoping Amy might mention a little bit about her experiences at the wonderful Rainbow Camp.
The Rainbow Camp,
yes.
Did you hear that?
Yes.
Congratulations on your show, and thank you very much.
Thanks. Now, were you able to hear?
Yes.
Okay, I was like straining
to hear
it.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lynn.
Thank you.
Lynn actually said that she was happy to hear us. I mean, if people didn't hear, you know, to see her, she was a Rainbow Girl and involved.
I heard that part.
Yep, and she wants Amy to speak about our scholarship program and our Rainbow Camp.
Okay, I heard Rainbow Camp, that scholarship. Oh, you have a scholarship program.
We do. We have scholarship opportunities for the girls entering college and during their time in college. We have them through Rainbow and through our sponsoring bodies. So the Order of Eastern Star, Order of Amaranth, and the Masons all have scholarship opportunities. And Rainbow Camp is the most magical place in Massachusetts. We have week-long sessions at camp.
Okay.
And they'll get there on Sunday afternoon, and they'll stay for a whole week.
Okay.
And they participate in classes like swimming, archery, riflery, canoeing, arts and crafts.
So like the stereotypical scouting things.
Yes.
Sorry.
In the summer. It's okay.
It's a lot of fun. We have...
Please say you don't wear the big long white...
No. Absolutely not.
Sorry.
No. And it's really cool. We stay in cabins, and the cabins have been there since camp first opened. And we write our names and messages all over the cabins.
Oh,
so you can see from a long time ago, a lot of the girls now see their mom's names, and which is really nice. And it's a great way to meet different girls from all over the states. So that's where a lot of friendships are made at camp.
Now, is there one camp for the whole state?
Yes. And we also have girls from other states come. We have a lot of Rhode Island, New Hampshire, the New England states. This year we had Pennsylvania and Florida come.
Wow.
Yes, which was very exciting for us. We haven't had someone from Florida that far come, and they all had a great time when they came.
Excellent.
So it's really nice. I met most of my really close friends at camp, and that would make me want to go and travel to their assembly, whether it be in Taunton, like right next door, or if it was in Billerica or Natick. I mean, I have traveled a lot of places because of camp, which is really nice.
Oh, okay. It's always nice having that contact at the other end. Okay. Now, back to the scholarship program. Can a girl reapply for a scholarship in multiple years, or is it like a one-time only thing?
Yes, they can reapply.
Because I've noticed, like, back when I went to college, ancient history, a lot of times it was like, when you were entering college, you had a boatload of scholarships, and then after that, you were up a tree without a paddle. So it's something like sophomore year, junior year, you could reapply, theoretically?
Yes, and there's different scholarships available for the different grade levels as you advance in college, yes.
Neat. Okay, with high schools, talking about, you know, the schooling with high, or were you all set with that?
Yeah.
Okay, I don't want to interrupt you. A lot of high schools now require service for graduation requirements. Can girls use their service opportunities through Rainbow as some of those requirements, or is that like double dipping and not allowed?
Well, for Rainbow, I know in my school, because I'm in a sorority at school, and I know I have to complete hours of service for school. But those, I can use those for Rainbow, but I can't necessarily use my Rainbow service hours. Some schools do allow you to, as long as you get signed off. But I know there's different levels of like service awards in Rainbow that you can use any service hours that you get from anywhere, whether it be at school or in Rainbow.
So it's kind of like on a case-by-case basis. Okay.
Yeah, I think it really depends on the school and the program and what their requirements are.
Because it seems like there really is a heavy emphasis on service.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, you're out planning these events, and you know, the planning itself is service to your community, and then the event, like the whole Cradles to Crayons thing that you had mentioned.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's a big time commitment as well.
Yeah. Or I've had girls who have gotten credit for their Rainbow service, and I've signed off on it for them on programs that, you know, forms they've had to submit. So it does depend on the program.
Okay. Why is there a see, when I looked at the website, the first thing that was really surprising to me and also kind of intimidating was the emphasis on memorization. Now, you'd mentioned each role has to memorize like certain lines, even if it is only a couple of lines. Why is there that emphasis there?
You know, it is unfamiliar to a lot of people today. It's a little bit of a older concept.
Okay.
But what it does for the girls, a couple things. One mm-hmm. is it gives them an opportunity to start practicing that public speaking skill
okay.
where they know what they're going to say and what they're supposed
okay.
to say. So it's not that it's easy to memorize it, but that by memorizing that work, they get up there and they're confident in what
okay.
they're doing. Also,
yeah, see, I'd be just afraid of forgetting everything.
At first, yes, but we work with you on that. And that's one of the skills you develop over time.
Okay.
But another reason I think that the memorization is important is I mentioned about the symbolism mm-hmm. and the ceremonies that we have in Rainbow. And those lessons stay with you. If you memorize the lesson, when you're in the Office of Love and you memorize the lesson of love, mm-hmm. that's with you. It's with you 5, 10, 15, 50 years later when you need to remind yourself about that mm-hmm. because something's happening in your life. And I think I've had many adults who were in Rainbow tell me how the lesson of immortality helped them get through a death or those kinds of things.
Okay.
So that's another reason. And, you know, I think also it's because it makes our ceremonies much more beautiful. If a girl is presenting with confidence from memory without reading from a book, mm-hmm. It really makes an impact on a new girl when she's joining or on the public when they're watching one of our ceremonies. So there's a lot of reasons why that you wouldn't think of that it's actually really useful.
Yeah, you're right.
And they work hard. Our girls work very hard on memorizing their parts. So when they say it and they say it with confidence, they're very proud of themselves, which is very nice to see.
Oh, I would be.
Yes.
We, believe it or not, are almost out of time. So my last question is, if someone wants to become a Rainbow Girl, what's the best way to proceed?
They should go on our websites.
Okay.
We have a Massachusetts website, which is www.massiorg.net.
Okay.
Or the Supreme Assembly, which will direct them anywhere, which is gorainbow.org.
I think that's the one I found out. And they could find out a local assembly in the area and contact them?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. There's actually a thing right on the Supreme website, gorainbow.org, where they can do a zip code search, fill out a form, and we'll get a request for more information. They can also look for us out in the community. The girls
okay.
are out there on service projects and things. And if you know what you're looking for and you see them, we're there.
So what would they be looking for? The white gowns or those uniforms?
These shirts, the red shirts in Concord. When
I
we
love the white
candy.
Gown thing. That's like really cool.
Different kinds of things like that. And the Wamisit Assembly is having a fundraiser in Bedford.
That's right.
At the, what's the name of the pizza place?
Flatbread.
Flatbread Pizza.
Flatbread Pizza, the best pizza ever.
October 22nd from 5 okay. o'clock on. A portion of the proceeds of all the flatbread sales are going to go to them, so that would be a great okay. way to support them.
But and they'll have, like, information available so people can find out more.
Sure.
Excellent. Well, thank you both very much for coming. And, oh, wait, we do still have a little bit of time, in 30 seconds or less.
Yeah.
Tell me about your upcoming statewide project.
The food pantry?
Was that the Charlotte's Web
thing? Oh,
well,
the theme for this year is Weaving the Web of Friendship with okay. Massachusetts Rainbow. And we're going based off of Charlotte's Web. It's inspired by Charlotte's Web. So
cool.
We have pigs and farm animals, and we're using the Greater Boston Food Bank as our service this year because it incorporates farming. And
excellent. Yeah. All right. Once again, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
And hopefully, maybe we'll have you back in another, 6 months or a year.
We'd love
or
to.
When you graduate, when somebody new comes in. But thank you very much. Hopefully, we will see you again around the community. And I want to thank the viewers at home for tuning in, and thank you, Lynn, for calling. And feel free to check out the BCAT webpage for this show, where you'll be able to follow a link to see this episode again and others. So thank you very much, and have a wonderful evening. Good night.